Welcome to the lecture today. We want to look today into the idea of convolutions in order to define local operators. And we will look into a very simple form of those local operators, namely smoothing filters. So filters that smooth the intensity values in our image. And this is just the first part of the lecture on local operators using convolutions. There's a second part where we look into other filters, such as computing the gradients of an image, for example. So just as a short reminder, we have different types of operators that are out there. We had the point operators, we had the local operators, and we had the global operators. And so far we discussed the point operators, where only one intensity value defines from the input image defines how the intensity value of the output image actually looks like. And we want to look today into the local operators, which take a local neighborhood into account in order to determine the output intensity value. That means from our input image, we not just take one intensity value into account, one pixel value, but we take a neighborhood of that pixel into account in order to define the operation that generates our output intensity value. So why do we care about local operators? Why aren't point operators enough to define all the, let's say, relevant operations on images? So point operators are kind of limited, especially in the sense they cannot deal well with noise in our image, because it just takes one single measurement into account, one single intensity value, and not multiple measurements, multiple intensity values. The local operators, in contrast to that, take a neighborhood into account, and that means has multiple intensity measurements, and thus can do things like averaging over those values in order to better deal with noise. So this is an example on one of those images where we look into the kind of gradient structure. If we, for example, want to detect edges here around the boundaries of that person, so these are here highlighted in white. And you can see here in the grass area, for example, that there's a lot of noisy gradients are actually popping up. And if I'm interested in the main edges of that image, I'm probably not interested here in those intensity values on the grass, but rather than the boundaries here of that person, for example. So if we just take the intensity values at a single point into account, then we actually can't do this, and even if a very small neighborhood, we will generate all those edges over here. And the larger we are making our neighborhood, the better we can smooth out certain effects in here. And that's the reason why we leave the point operators today and want to look into local operators. So functions that not just take a single intensity value as their input, but actually a local neighborhood into it. And we are looking into those local neighborhoods that take into account the local neighborhood. They are sometimes also called neighborhood operators. And we will look into the concept of convolution as a framework for defining or specifying those local operators. And so convolutions is a powerful concept that tells us how we can combine two functions to get out new third functions. And we are using this. One function is kind of the input image, and the second function is a way that defines the actual local operator that we are generating, and those together generate a new function, namely the modified image or the transformed image. And this is a powerful concept in which we can embed all the different local operators that we are going to define in this lecture and the second part of it in order to put them into the same framework. And we look into techniques to perform noise reduction in an image by taking multiple intensity measurements into account, binomial filter, and then the second part we look into gradients and other type of operators so that we can, for example, compute also the first derivative of an intensity value in an image. But this happens in the second part. For the first part, we are looking into the techniques in order to smooth out our image. And the first and easiest thing that we can do if we want to take a neighborhood into account is use a so-called box filter. So what the box filter basically does, it defines a small box, a local neighborhood, over the image, over pixels. For example, not just the pixel I want to compute itself, but maybe it's eight neighbors into account, and then simply computes the average, so the mean intensity value in this box, in this local neighborhood, and replaces the intensity value at our target location with the mean of intensity values computed in that local box. So if we have a one-dimensional signal, as shown over here, or a two-dimensional signal like an image over here, and what we're then doing is we are basically having a local sum k, and this k defines the neighborhood, for example, one pixel to the left, the current pixel, and one pixel to the right, or 3 pixels to the left and 3 pixels to the right, whatever we want to define in here, this is defined through this k. And then we are simply taking if the index I is what I want to compute, I'm basically taking all the neighborhood values into account. I sum up all the intensity values and then divide it by k, by the number of neighbors that I'm actually considering. And this simply computes a local mean from my signal. I can do the same, of course, also in 2D. Then I have to iterate over the index k and l, once for the rows and the other one for the columns, and in this way compute the average in that local neighborhood in this box and replace the intensity value by the mean intensity value. So what it does is basically you have your image, and for every pixel you look into the local neighborhood, compute the mean intensity value, and replace the actual intensity value through its mean. So we'll get a smoothed version of that image. Let's make a small example in 1D how that looks like. So let's say I have a function here which has five discrete values, 100, 126, 110, 97, and 99. You can see this as a one-dimensional image, for example, 5 pixel intensity values. And let's say we take a small local neighborhood into account. Let's say k equals minus 1, 0, and 1. That means 0 is the intensity value, the index of the intensity value that we want to compute. So plus and minus 1 means 1 to the left and 1 to the right. And then we can generate our output signal. So for example, if we pick this element here in the middle, 110, and we compute this sum, that means we are computing the average of 126, 110, and 97, and compute the average value here. So this would give us 333. So if you sum up all three values, gives us 303. You need to divide by 3, so the output intensity value should be 111 over here. If we do this, we can see here the result. 111 is obtained by summing up 126, 110, 97, and dividing the result by 3 gives us 111. And the same we can do for this 126. Then the sum would be 100 plus 126 plus 110 divided by 3 gives me 112, and so on and so forth. I can't really do this for the first and for the last element, because here there is no intensity value here above, or for 99 the intensity value below defined. So I put a question mark in here. This is something we will deal with later. And so we can only compute this average, this mean intensity value for those elements here, which are not at the borders of the image. And so this is a very simple operation which smooths this signal into a smooth signal over here by computing the mean intensity value over that local neighborhood here defined through 3 pixels, once to the left, the pixel under consideration, and the pixel on the other side. And this is a simple 1D example for such a box filter. And of course, we can do exactly the same thing also in 2D. So this is an example. This is my input intensity value. So we have intensity values of 0 all over here, 90 all over here, and yet 0 over here. And this is my local box filter here defined with a 3x3 neighborhood. That means the 9 intensity values are averaged into one intensity value. So if this is the pixel value I want to compute, so the output, this GIJ, is this one over here. And then I'm looking into the local neighborhood defined by minus 1, 0, 1, minus 1, 0, 1 for the x and y coordinate, or the row and the column in my image. This gives me this 3x3 neighborhood. And what happens, I'm basically sliding this 3x3 neighborhood over my image, like this, and then can compute always the corresponding intensity value over here in my output image. So in this example, it's 0 plus 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 0. So 9 times 0 is divided by 9 is 0. So we should get a 0 over here. And this is exactly what happens. So we obtain a 0 over here. Then we move on. Here the sum is 90. 0 everywhere except here, so 90. 90 divided by 9, because I'm 9 pixels I'm considering, gives me 10. So I'm putting in here the intensity value of 10. And again, shifting those ones to the right again. Here I have 2 times 90, so 180 in sum. 180 divided by 9 gives me 20. So I have the intensity value of 20 over here. And I can repeat this process. There I have 3 times 90, so I get the intensity value of 30 in here. And I can basically slide this over the whole image, through every row, every column, and then I get my smoothed image. And again, I can't do this at the moment at the boundaries, because then the neighborhood is not fully defined. So as a result of this, I get this smooth variant of an image, where I get intensity values from 0 to 90. So here is the maximum value of 90. This is this one computed over here, for example, because here in the whole neighborhood, there are only maximum value of 90. So this gives me a value of 90. Same for this pixel over here. But if I'm here near the 0, the sum will be smaller, and thus also the smooth value will be smaller. What you can see here, this one single hole, which wasn't the input image, is actually smoothed away here. So the values decrease, get smaller over here, but you can't see this hole anymore in that part of the image. So this is an example of applying this 2D box filter over, over the image. And what I can do now is, well, the question is, I'm now looking into how can I actually define these type of operators in a good way. And I can do this by defining one function which tells me how that pattern looks like, how this neighborhood looks like. So basically how this box is actually being computed. This is one function. This is a function that we're going to call our kernel function. And then my original input function, and I'm basically combining the input function and this kernel function to generate me the output function, which is this one over here. And I'm doing this with this so-called kernel. So what happens is basically I have two functions here, my function w and my function f. My function f is my input image, my function g is my output image, and I have a, it's called a weighting function that tells me what's the weight of the corresponding intensity value at that image location, which should be taken into account in order to compute a sum, summing up all those values with this kind of small weight matrix over here in order to generate the output function. And this function w is called the weight, or weight function, or it's called the kernel function, or kernel. And it basically specifies the weighted sum, so the weights of a sum that I'm creating of intensity values from the function f that generates me my output function g. And depending on the kernel that I'm actually specifying, I generate different smoothing behaviors. So in the example we had before, in this example over here, I'm treating all pixels alike. So all those pixel intensity values here should have the same values, the same weight. So it's actually, in this example, a weight of 1 divided by 9, because I have 9 pixels over here. So 1 divided by 9. So this would be a weight matrix, or a kernel function, which only consists of the value 1 divided by 9 in this 3 by 3 neighborhood, and basically 0 everywhere else. So through this weight function w, through the design of this weight function or this kernel, I can specify the behavior, how my local operator should actually look like. And it basically defines the weights that I'm computing by summing up the weighted values in a local neighborhood. Then there are certain properties, they're so-called the linear and shift invariant filters. These are filters that we will be looking in here. So if I have a filter, in this case called L, which takes my input function f into account, generates my output function, and this L can be defined, for example, by this kernel function over here, then this is called linear and shift invariant if the following two properties hold. That means if I can specify two functions, f1 and f2, for example, two images that I'm overlaying, with the weight, how much this image is weighted, then this is equivalent for computing the the L functions of the individual image 1 and image 2 and simply add them up. And the same holds, and similarly, I can basically have a shift invariance into account. So I'm basically getting the same result if I'm just shifting my kernel over the image, and I'm getting the same result that I can perform the shift in the input as well as in the output. So we're looking here into this linear and shift invariant filters. And this brings me to the next definition. It's basically very close to what we had before. So this is exactly the function that I'd specified before with this weight function over here, and or this kernel function. And the key thing is this form, what I've written down here, is actually the definition of a convolution. A convolution of two functions, of a function w and a function f, which generates a new function g, written in this form here. So this means I have a convolution of my kernel w and my function f to generate a new function g. And this is this definition here. In the discrete world, in the continuous world, we would have an integral sitting over here. So if you look to this function, what it's actually doing is, what it does, it basically takes my kernel and slides this kernel over the function f. And in every position, it basically computes the sum of all values, or computes the integral over this combined function. And the output of this integral, so the result of this integral from minus infinity to infinity, actually provides me with the function value g. So you can see this as two functions which are sliding onto each other, always computing the integral, which in the integral generates you the actual value of my output. We have seen this in this example of the image with this 2D box, which I'm sliding over the image. This is this operation that I was doing. I was living in a continuous world, so I don't need to integrate. I just need to sum up all the intensity values in there. And by sliding over this, this is basically this sliding the kernel over that function and always computing the integral or the sum of the intensity values, which gives me the single intensity value in my new output image. And this is the more formal definition of this convolution, or in German Faltung, which is the mathematical concept which does exactly this operation here. And what we can do now is we can say, this is our output function, this is our input function, and I just have to define my kernel and perform a convolution of the kernel and my input image in order to generate the output image. And this allows me to define local operators. Of course, we can make this local neighborhood larger and larger and larger, and theoretically we could make this w a very large function, as large as the original input. So as a result of this, we may take into account the whole image and end up at a global operator. So this is possible. I can generate global operators also with these operations here. In the example that we are providing here, however, the kernel function will be zero except in a very small area of the overall image. So this leads then to a local operator. So now let's see how we can use this box filter that we just have specified before as computing the average of the neighboring pixels in order to use it in form of a convolution. And we use this with a box filter, which will be in the whole lecture called R, or rectangular filter, it's also called. That's where the R stems from. It has two values over here. The value here on top is the dimensionality, and the value down here is a neighborhood, so the size of the neighboring pixels. How many pixels am I taking into account? So R2 over here means it's two-dimensional, and 3 means I have 3 neighboring pixels in every dimension. So if R13 is an one-dimensional box filter with a neighborhood of 3, so 1, 2, 3 elements shown over here. Or in the 2D case, I have 3 by 3 elements, so 9 elements. All elements here are 1, and the factor 1/9, so I could also write 1/9 in here. What you also see is there is one value which is underlined in this matrix, and this underlining means this is the element where the index 0 is specified for. So if I'm addressing this box filter with the index 0, 0, 0, 0 in this case, or just 0, then I'm ending up at the underlined element, you know, to kind of properly specify where the 0 index is. So whenever it's, sometimes I'm leaving this out, and then it's always kind of the center pixel. Sometimes it's explicitly provided if I'm I have not an odd but an even number of elements in here defining the neighborhood in a slightly different way, then it's important to have this underlined value specified so I know where my zero index is. Okay, so my claim is that with this definition of the box filter of a kernel, we actually emulate a box filter. And we can very easily also show that. So we have our function g, which I can define through with a kernel function, which I'm not specifying at that moment, and my function f and my kernel going over the neighborhood from minus 1 to 1 over here. Okay, what happens? I can basically, what does it mean? I can basically expand this into three terms which form a sum. So I'm starting at k equals minus 1, so this is w of minus 1 times f of I minus minus 1, w0 fi, w1 of ai minus 1. And then I can actually combine that together. So this is, what I then do, I'm specifying a kernel function which just says it's 1 divided by 3. So this was in every position. So this is exactly this definition that I was specifying. I'm actually putting this in here. So I'm setting the kernel to 1 divided by 3 for the index minus 1, 0, and 1, and 0 everywhere else. So this gives me 1 divided by 3, 1 divided by 3, 1 divided by 3, which I've computed over here. And then this is nothing else than a third and the sum of the intensity values, and this is exactly my definition of the box filter with a neighborhood 3. So this box filter takes the average intensity value of the neighboring pixels. Here the neighborhood size is defined by 3, one pixel to the left, the index, and the pixel to the right, and this can be expressed with a convolution where the kernel function is 1 divided by 3. So this is basically the average that I had before, and this is my my convolution, so I can express my averaging as a convolution. And I can do this analogously for the 2D setup. Okay, so let's see what is the effect of such a box filter onto a function. So if I have my input function f over here, so these are just the intensity values over here, and then I can compute f convolved with my box filter over here, and then I get that kind of smoothed variant of the function. So for every intensity value here, it is computed by the mean of the neighboring value. So this is the value 9. So I go to 9 over here. So this value, so I take this value and compute the sum of those three values, which gives me this value over here. And I'm basically doing this for all points, and I get this smoothed signal. And now I can actually look how does the function changes if I'm increasing the neighborhood. If I take a box filter, which doesn't have, let's say, a neighborhood 3, but a neighborhood of 5. So I'm increasing the neighborhood, making the neighborhood larger, and taking more pixels into account, or intensity values of pixels into account, in order to perform that averaging. And if I do this, instead of with a kernel of size 3, I take a kernel of size 5, I again get a smooth signal over here. And what you can see here, this is even a smoother function than it was before, because I'm basically taking more values into account for that averaging, and in this case, generating an even smoother function out of this. So the larger the neighborhood of this box filter, the larger the effect of the smoothing that I have. So the larger the neighborhood, the stronger the smoothing effect on my image. And if, which makes sense, if I make it much smaller, and let's say I just have a kernel of size 1, so no neighborhood, this would basically be the neutral element. It wouldn't change the original image. Then there's no smoothing ongoing, and the larger I make the neighborhood, the stronger the smoothing effect that I actually see. Okay, so my box kernel, so my kernel for that box filter, is a matrix or vector all containing 1s, and then 1 divided by the number of element here before, and this was my pixel with the 0, 0 index. And so this is the standard box kernel that we use in when we're working with images, the 2D kernel, in order to smooth a 2D image. And this box filter has the effect of a noise reduction. So if I have a certain noise in my input image, so my intensity values are affected by noise, then through this smoothing operation, through this box filter, I can reduce the noise and smoothing my signal. And the question is, how strong is this effect of that smoothing? And we can see that for the box filter, we can derive an equation. If this is the noise that I have in my input signal, and this is the my output, then this is the noise of my output image, and there's a relationship between them. This is 1 divided by the square root of the size of the neighborhood in the 1D case, or just 1 divided by the neighborhood size in the two-dimensional case. So we can see this value is smaller or equal than 1. It's exactly 1 when I basically have a zero neighborhood. That means no smoothing operation is performed, and then also the noise isn't changed. But for any neighborhood larger than 1, this is always a value which is smaller than 1. That means my output standard deviation is smaller than my input standard deviation. And we can see also the relationship in general of my kernel function, basically looking into the sum of squares of the intensity values gives me the relationship between the variances of the input and the output image. And besides this kind of computing the mean intensity value, what the box filter does, we also can have a variant of that, which is the median filter, where I'm computing the median for every intensity value. This is more robust against individual outlier values, for example. So if I have individual intensity values which are very low outliers, much larger than their neighborhood or much smaller, then the median filter does a better job. But it's not a linear filter anymore, because I'm only computing the median in the local neighborhood and not just the mean, where every element in the neighborhood has the same contribution. This is not the case for the median anymore. Okay, so we now have an idea how that box filter works in an image or in 1D signal. I can even generalize this to higher dimensions if I want to, but here we are at least for now staying in this 1D or 2D world, mainly 2D world when we are working with images. So what were we actually doing at the borders of the image? So we had seen that there's an area, if I have a border pixel, for example, and then the kernel overlaps with an area that lies outside the actual image. So far we have ignored it and simply not computed the convolved signal at that location, but maybe I actually want to do this if I want to smooth the whole image, for example. So how do I do this? And this is an operation, what we can do is, which is called padding, which basically means we are extending the image, and the question is, how should we actually extend it? And there are different ways how I can do this. The simplest operation would be, okay, I'm just adding a zero. It's just outside what I have seen, I'm just putting a constant value in there. For example, zero everywhere. Or maybe I take the mean intensity value over all image pixels that I have and assume a mean value out there, also some constant value that I'm specifying. Or I'm having a cyclic wrap, so basically if I'm moving outside the image on the right, I'm just going into the image and taking the value from the left-hand side, just kind of basically copying the image over. Or I have a clamping operation, which means I'm basically repeating the last intensity value into the outside world, or I'm mirroring the image and basically copy a mirrored version of the image to the outside world in order to compute the boundaries correctly. So a few examples. So this is basically a padding with zero, just adding zeros, constant intensity values. Or I have this wrap, so if I'm actually moving out of the image over here, I'm actually moving to the other side and copying the values over. So these four intensity values over here correspond to those four intensity values. Or I have a clamping operation, basically means I'm just repeating the pixel intensity value to the outside world. Or I'm doing a mirroring, where I'm basically taking the image and mirror the image over here so that I have so this is the mirroring line over here. So those four pixels are exactly like those four pixels over here. So there are different ways how I can perform this padding, and it's basically a user-defined way on what should I do with locations where I simply don't know the intensity value. It's basically your prior how the world looks like there, and you as a user can specify it or have to specify it. Okay, so this was kind of the very basics of the box filter of smoothing an image. And introducing the idea of convolutions, or using the definition of a convolution to define a kernel function which describes how this box filter actually operates. And we can do that again with a variant of the box filter, so the binomial filter or binomial filter in German, which is basically an approximation of a Gaussian distribution, so performing a Gaussian smoothing. So the binomial filter, as the box filter, performs a smoothing, except that it doesn't compute just the mean of the intensity values in the local neighborhood, but basically takes the shape of a Gaussian distribution. That means the intensity value at the 0, 0 location, at the index 0, 0, has a higher impact than the intensity values at further locations which are further away. And we're doing this by using an approximation of a Gaussian as my kernel function, and basically discrete approximations is due to the pixels, because we are not interpolating between pixel values over here. We're just taking actual pixel values, so we don't have a generate a higher resolution image, for example. And then we could use the Gaussian itself, but here we are just using an approximation of the Gaussian given by the coefficients of the binomial distribution in the that we're using. And this defines the weights, and the weights of this kernel is then also the elements you've seen in Pascal's triangles. So if you build up Pascal's triangles, the individual rows in Pascal's triangles actually give you the are the elements of the binomial distributions, and thus are an approximation or discrete approximation of the Gaussian distribution. So as for an example, these are the binomial kernels in the 1D case. So the values 1, 2, 1, or 1, 4, 6, 4, 1, always by the corresponding normalizing term over here, so that's a sum over all values gives one, otherwise you would change the mean intensity value. So in this case, smallest case means the pixel in the middle, so that with index 0, 0, counts twice as much as the pixels which are further away. So I'm giving a stronger weight to the pixel which is closer to the index that I'm actually computing. Same here, 6 is larger than 4, and 4 is larger than 1, so the further I'm actually moving away from the zero index, the smaller the weight, so the smaller the contribution of those intensity values. If I now write down Pascal's triangle, this one, and this is kind of all, the, kind of every element in here is the sum of the neighbors on the top and the left. So 2 is the result of 1 plus 1, 3 is the result of 2 plus 1, 6 is the result of 3 plus 3, 4 is the result of 3 plus 1, and so on and so forth. So I can very easily build up Pascal's triangle, one of the, let's say, standard examples for a recursive function that you use if you learned how to program. You can compute Pascal's triangle, and the individual rows of Pascal's triangle are an approximation of a Gaussian, discrete Gaussian distribution. And these are exactly our kernels. So in this example, B2 is kind of here. This is row 0, row 1, row 2. This is the second row of Pascal's triangle. So this would be my binomial filter. I'm typically interested in those in values which have an odd number, so that the center element here is the index 0, 0. And so this means I have a neighborhood 2 to the left and 2 to the right. There's a neighborhood 1 to the left and 1 to the right. But from the definition point of view, this is always the corresponding row here in Pascal's triangle that I'm using. Okay, so how does this look like? The binomial kernel, this is again my input function, and this is my binomial kernel with a neighborhood 2. That means the kernel 1, 2, 1, or with the 4 kernel, which would be 1, 4, 6, 4, 1. And I'm performing this smoothing. Then again, this is a kernel with a larger neighborhood. This is a kernel with a smaller neighborhood. So the effect of the larger neighborhood is a stronger smoothing, which you can clearly see here. This is a smoother function compared to this function over here. And again, here, the values here at the boundaries, there's a cyclic wrap. So in order to convolve this point over here or this point over here, I'm taking this point into account and that point on the other side. For averaging this, this is how I get that result. So there's a cyclic wrap as the padding operation done over here. And I can do the same thing which I can do in 1D, I can also do in 2D. So this is kind of my 1D kernel and this is my 2D kernel. This is basically a combination of a kernel fall in the x direction as well as in the y direction, or in the row and the column direction, which then I can basically combine those two and obtain here the binomial kernel in the two-dimensional case, which I would then use in order to smooth an image. And this is basically, again, as I said, an approximation of a two-dimensional Gaussian distribution at discrete locations. And this is what if you use your favorite image processing program and you perform a Gaussian blur on an image, it basically takes those kernels over here and move them over the whole image and computes a blurring effect. So this is in this example over here. This is my input function f, the old logo of the University of Bonn here, or parts of it. And if I perform here a smoothing operation, this is now a binomial kernel with a size 30, that you can see the smoothing effect stronger here on that video. You can see that all the kind of the sharp boundaries are strongly smoothed out because I'm taking a fairly large neighborhood into account, approximating the weights with the Gaussian values of a Gaussian distribution and computing this smoothed version of the image. So this is Gaussian blur applied to that image, which happens by using these kernels over here, just extended, not just with the fourth line of Pascal's triangle, but in this case, using the 30th line of Pascal's triangle, just to make this effect stronger, that it's easier to visualize over here. So this is, again, a variant of one of those local operators that now just not uses a mean and averaging in the whole box, but gives a stronger weight to the elements close to the index. And also this has a noise reducing effect. So we obtain a new output image and we want to maybe specify the input output relation of that noise term. And again, have here the noise of my input and the noise of my output image. And specifying in the one-dimensional case and in for the two-dimensional case. And I see here a different factor that sits in front of those functions compared to the box kernel. So for the box kernel, this was 1 divided by square root of m and 1 divided by m. Here, those values are smaller. So I have first this factor pi in here, and here's kind of the fourth square root, and here is the fourth root, and here's the square root. So those values will be smaller. So the those values will be larger. Those smoothing effect will be smaller of the binomial kernel. So if I have two kernels, one box filter, box kernel, and one binomial kernel with the same neighborhood size, so the same actual size, then the smoothing effect of one will be smaller than the smoothing effect of the other. And I can specify this to something which we can call the degree of smoothing. The degree of smoothing is basically the standard deviation of the output divided by the standard deviation of the input. And this value basically tells me how much is the smoothing effect of this kernel. And then I can compute this for the box filter as well as for the binomial kernel. And I can see a different relationship that we have over here. So the if I want to have the same degree of smoothing, I need a smaller neighborhood for the box kernel and a larger neighborhood for the binomial, because the smoothing effect of the binomial is smaller. So if I want to have a certain degree that I want to have, so for example of 0.2, this ratio should be 0.2, then I need to take a kernel size of 5 in terms of the box filter, or a size of 8 for the binomial filter to have the same effect of smoothing. So the box filter smooths stronger, is a stronger smoothing effect than the binomial filter. Okay, so we have now seen two examples of kernel functions that I can use in this framework of convolutions in order to perform smoothing operations on our image. This was the box kernel as well as the binomial kernel. And in the remaining part of that lecture, I want to now dive a little bit into the convolutions and explain a few properties of the convolutions that later on become handy if you want to do certain operations or combine kernels and do certain operations. So it's worth looking a little bit into the properties of this of the convolution. So I've seen that these linear filters can be expressed as convolutions because I have this weight matrix and I'm basically computing weighted sums of these intensity values or these input function values in order to define the output function values. And so it makes sense to analyze a little bit the properties of this convolution. So we have our output image, our kernel that basically describes what we want to do with our image, which form of smoothing, and our input image, which is inserted in here. And so what we can do is we go back to the definition of the kernel function, here expressed, or as general two functions, A and B, to avoid this word F and W in here, because F is always our input image and W is always our smoothing kernel. So therefore I just used here the functions A and B, because in the end it turns out that this will be arbitrary. So we have a function A and a function B. We perform the convolutions between A and B, and the sum goes over all possible intensity values, all possible indices, so from minus infinity to infinity, and gives me my new function C. And of course, in reality, or in practice, if I'm operating this, I will only need to sum about the size of the kernel, because everything outside is assumed to be zero. And so I don't need to have this infinite sum. If I implement it, I only need to take the size of the kernel into account. I guess that's obvious. But if we don't specify the size of A, we have to go from minus infinity to infinity over here. And we can do the same in the two-dimensional case. We have then a two-dimensional kernel function and a two-dimensional image function over here with the indices I and J, and our index K and L iterating over the first and the second dimension of our image. And then we write this as in this form with this star operation over here, as the convolution C is defined as a convolution of the function A and the function B. So the first thing in terms of properties that this convolution has is this is actually a commutative operation. So it doesn't matter if I say C equals B convolved with A or A convolved with B, this is exactly the same result. So the commutative property holds for the convolution. So A convolved with B is the same than B convolved with A. We can very easily show that by just going to the definition of the convolution, which is specified over here. And now my index K in here is just a sum which goes from minus infinity to infinity. So it covers all possible intensity values. So what I can do is I can just generate a replacement and changing the indices K and I minus K here arbitrarily. So I generate a new index J, which is defined by I minus K. And so I'm replacing I minus K with J. So I will put a J over here. And in a second step, I can say K is I minus J. So this I minus J actually goes in here. And then I'm simply iterating still from minus infinity to infinity, now over this index J, and I obtain exactly the same equation, except that the indices in the function A and B have been swapped. And I'm summing over a different variable, but this doesn't matter because it's a variable I'm summing from minus infinity up to plus infinity. So just with a very small replacement of indices, I can actually show the commutative property. So it doesn't matter if I say A convolved with B or B convolved with A. So it doesn't matter if I convolve the kernel with my image or the image with my kernel. This is exactly the same operation, the same result that I will get out of that. Then there are further properties which hold, like the associative property, as we know it from standard operations like multiplication or adding two values, the distributive property. So if I'm adding two functions and convolve it with C, it is equivalent to take the first function, convolve it with C, and then add the second function convolved with C to it. And also scalar multiplication is the same that I know before. So alpha times A plus B is the same as alpha times A convolved with B, or alpha convolved with lambda times B. So it's just a constant factor that I have over here. I said alpha, lambda, sorry. It's just a scalar multiplication that I have in here. There's also a neutral element to the convolution. So basically, with which function should I convolve a function A so that the result will be A again? We had seen this in an example before. If I reduce the box filter to a size of 1, which is basically the index 0, 0 has the element 1, everything else is 0. This is actually a neutral element which just doesn't change my function. I can also define it more formally. It's kind of the unit impulse. So this is kind of a function which is 0 everywhere, just 1 at the position which I'm interested in. And same for this matrix. So these are all zeros everywhere. I just have this 1 over here. So this is the neutral impulse, or the unit impulse, the neutral element for the convolution. So if I convolve a function with this unit impulse, it is a neutral element. That means it doesn't change the function itself. What we can, however, do with this impulse, especially in image domain, if we just shift this one to a different position but keep everything else zero, then we can actually realize also shifts in an image due to the convolution, because then it's basically a copying operation that I'm copying the index, which is one. Let's say I move it 2 pixels to the left, then it basically corresponds to a shift of 2 pixels when I'm sliding this kernel over my image. So if I want to generate a shift of my in my image, I can actually do this using the unit impulse, just changing the indices over here. And this is kind of equivalent to kind of, at least from an intuition point of view, of moving this one to a different location in my kernel, in my matrix over here. And so I can use this convolution also to describe something like shifting elements in an image, or shifting pixels around, basically. Also, the convolution is maybe an interesting property, is actually similar to multiplication, but using a different form for the carry, so in German the Übertrag. So if you remember how you multiplied two numbers in school, so 121 times 121, you were writing these values, multiplying 1 with 121, 2 with 121, 1 with 121, writing them down here and adding them up. You can do the same thing in order to compute a convolution of two kernels. So these are your two input functions. You convolve them with each other. Then this is the result. The only difference is if you compute the sum over here, and this sum would be larger than 10, you wouldn't add the value to the next digit. You would keep kind of a 10 over here. And this is kind of uses the carry in a different way. And those two underlined values here are the extensions. So that means if I perform a convolution of this binomial kernel with itself, then I'm actually getting another binomial kernel. So if this is the row 2, and this is also the row 2 of my Pascal's triangle, it will give me a row 4 of that triangle. So basically, it was extending the kernel here by two elements, creating a kernel with a larger neighborhood. These are those two values over here, and so creating here this new kernel. So, and this is, again, I can compute this in a very similar way as I was using this for the multiplication. I only need to make sure that the carry information is taken properly into account. I can also, in some situations, perform a deconvolution, so undo a convolution, but this only works if the inverse of that function I'm performing the convolution with actually exists. So if this inverse does not exist, then this deconvolution is not defined. But if it exists, then I can actually perform a deconvolution and reverse the operation that I'm actually doing. But if you think, for example, about a box kernel, that becomes tricky, because the box function is a function which is not invertible. And as a result of this, this doesn't hold for the example that we have actually shown over here at the moment. Another important property is the separability of kernels. The kernels are separable. So if I have my Gaussian kernel in the 2D world, I can actually express it as a Gaussian kernel, as two Gaussian kernels in the 1D world, or binomial kernels in the 1D world, one defined over the rows and the other one defined over the columns. So instead of having one 2D kernel, I can actually apply two 1D kernels, one on the rows and one on the columns. So B22 is equivalent to B12 convolved with B12 transposed, because this is just this kernel being transposed. Why would you care about this property? It's a property that becomes very useful because these operations over here are faster to compute in a computer than this operation over here. Why is this the case? If you think that you need to slide this kernel over all positions of an image, you always have to visit all 9 values, so 3x3 values, for every pixel in the image that I'm computing. In this example over here, I'm only have to use 3 values and again 3 values. So 3 plus 3 instead of 3 times 3. You can see this is turns out to be a quadratic number of operations that I need in the size of that matrix. And here it is just a linear operation. So in terms of the O notation, this means a quadratic number of operations that I need to execute here in order to compute the result of this 2D kernel. And here I only need to do twice a linear operation, which still is a linear operation. So this is still an O of n operation that I'm executing here. So if I have the separable kernels, it's always better to perform these operations rather than this operation because it's faster to execute in a computer. And so therefore, this is an important property when you think about computational speed or how fast you can actually compute those convolutions. What we can see here is this is actually a combination of multiple convolutions. So F convolved with this and then the result convolved with another operation. And so if you have multiple convolutions, we can actually combine them. And this is again one of the properties that we have seen before. So if we have these different kernels, I can just combine different kernels into one kernel function through convolutions and then convolve it with my image. So I can kind of combine multiple kernels into account. So I can perform multiple convolutions, and especially for the binomial filter, as we have seen it before, if I have the B1 kernel, so the first row of Pascal's triangle just consisting of 1, 1, and perform this convolution n times, I'm actually getting my the nth row of Pascal's triangle over here. So if I convolve this 20 times, I will actually get my 20th row of Pascal's triangle in terms of the coefficients that I actually get. Another important property I mentioned already before, all the smoothing kernels have the sum over all the weights must be 1, because if it wouldn't be 1, I would actually be changing the mean of my functions. If I perform multiple smoothing operations, I would actually change the mean value, something that I typically don't want to have. So for at least all the kernels that we've seen so far, the value is equal to 1, so the sum over all weights. There are, however, other kernels where this is not the case, which will be looked into in the part 2 of that lecture, where it makes sense to find other kernels. For example, if we want to compute derivatives, then this property, we will define kernels so that this property will not hold anymore, but then it's also not a smoothing kernel. Last but not least, I want to quickly talk about how to compute, for example, those box filters in an efficient way. And for that, an integral image is an interesting property. So an integral image is an image where at every location in an image, I'm basically summing all the intensity values for that pixel location and all pixels which are smaller or equal to that pixel in terms of the index in the columns and the rows. So I'm basically saying in the integral image Sij, I take all intensity values in my input image F, summing them up for all those values which are where the first or the second index is smaller or equal to the first or respectively second index of my query location. So I'm basically, if I have a large image, I'm taking a pixel and every pixel which has a smaller or equal index, so this block over here, I'm computing the sum of the intensity values. So it's basically the integral over that image up to that point that I have computed. And these integral images can be used to perform certain operations very efficiently in an image. So when we talk about feature computations, for example, those integral images can become very handy because they allow us to do certain operations very quickly. And I just want to provide here with one example that we can actually use it to very quickly compute a box filter without actually performing all the individual operations summing through all elements in here. And so if we have an image over here, let's say this is my image, then this is my integral image. So this value 3 is identical. This 5 is the sum of this and this value. So 2 plus 3 equals 5. 11 is the sum of all those pixel values. So 5 plus 1 is 6, plus 2 is 8, plus 3 is 11. So 11 sits here. And so on and so forth. So the further I go down, the larger the values actually get in this integral image. Okay, now let's say I compute once this integral image, which is an operation which is just linear in the number of of pixels in my input image. Then, once I have that integral image, I can actually compute the box filter operation very efficiently. So consider you want to compute the sum of the elements in here. Let's say, consider we take the box filter unnormalized, so just using the filter with ones everywhere without this normalizing constant, because normalization we can care about later. And we want to compute the sum of those 9 elements over here. What we can do is we can say, okay, that is actually this point in the intensity image, in the integral image, which kind of takes all values into account. Then I need to subtract those values which sit over here. So I say minus this element over here. So this is the kernel I want to compute, so I'm subtracting this value. I'm also subtracting this value, which are all elements which are smaller here. The only problem is this area now, I have counted twice, so I need to add it again. So by an operation of adding those two values minus those two values, I can compute the sum of intensity values which sit in the original image over here, no matter how large that integral image is or how large this kernel is. So with just adding four values, I'm actually able to compute the box filter for any arbitrary image size and kernel size with just four operations, a constant number of operations. The only thing I need to do once I need to compute the integral image. And this becomes very handy in order to do those computations in a very efficient manner. So integral images are often used if you need to add and subtract certain values or weights in this example that result from the intensity values. You can speed up operations with these integral images quite dramatically. And once you have all those values over here by saying, so in this case, 48 plus 3 is 51, minus 14 minus 13, you will get the sum of those values in here. Then if you divide this by 9, then you get actually the box filter as we know it, that has the sum of the elements, which equals to 1. Okay, with this, coming to the end, we have introduced linear filters as local operators, and those operators have been used. They take in multiple intensity values and map them to a new intensity value in my image, in contrast to the point operators, which just take one intensity value, and the global operators, which take the whole image into account. We use the framework of convolutions in order to define those operators, which is kind of attractive because I just need to define a kernel function which defines the operation that I'm doing and then performs the convolution of my actual image, of my actual signal that I want to convolve. And we have introduced a few important filters, just kind of two for now, which is the binomial filter and the box filter. And we will look into other filters in the second part of that lecture, where we look into computing derivatives especially. So things like the Sobel operator or SHA operator as ways for computing derivatives of images and then working with those derivatives, which is actually very, very useful. With this, thank you very much for your attention, and these convolutions and using these convolutions for defining those operators is standard thing in computer vision and image processing. So the Cyrill book, for example, provides you with good examples in case you want to dive a bit deeper. So with this, thank you very much for your attention, and looking forward to the second part of the lecture where we're looking into computing derivatives of my image intensity function. Thank you.